Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The choir will sing the anthem, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." Our call to worship, Lynn.
Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing to the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies come cringing to you. All the earth worships you and sings praises to you. They sing praises to your name.
We continue our worship in the hymn 184, "Sing to the Lord."
Thank you.
Let us make our approach to God. Let us pray. Eternal God, we come once more to this familiar place, at this familiar time, amongst familiar faces. We come as we have come so many times, to sing well-loved hymns, to meet well-loved people, and listen again to well-loved words of Scripture. Eternal God, we thank you for all that is indeed familiar, all that has become so much a part of our lives. But save us, we pray, from ever becoming over-familiar with you, so that we lose the sense of awe that we should feel in your presence. Over-familiar with one another, so that we lose sight of the worth in each one of us. Over-familiar with our faith, so that we come to see only what we expect, rather than everything you would show us. Over-familiar with the world about us, so that we fail to glimpse your hand at work in the words and wonder of creation. Living God, there is so much in our lives that is not as it should be, nor as it could be, and not as it would be, if only we walked more closely with you. Forgive us the unkind words, thoughtless actions, and unworthy thoughts that deny our faith. Forgive us the self-centered lifestyle, half-hearted commitment, and a careless discipleship that undermines our witness. Forgive us the lack of devotion, lack of faith, and lack of love that demean your name. Living God, we gather together in the name of Christ. Assure us as we worship you of the forgiveness, the guidance, the love, and the life you offer through him. And so may we worship you this morning, not just through our words, but in our lives. Not merely now, but always. Not simply here, but everywhere. To the glory of your name. And in the words of your Son who has taught us, we do further pray together and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A warm welcome to all to worship this morning. If there be any visitors with us, please do introduce yourself to me at the front door at the end of service, that I may welcome you as well as the congregation to the fellowship of St. Mary's. I commend to you the intimations are printed. A bit of sad news. I'm sorry to be able to say that our organist, Ronald Mackey's mother, died the night before last. After a very long and somewhat restricted life in latter years. But I'm sure it is our thoughts and our prayers that are with him, and we thank him for coming and being with us this morning, despite the greatness of his loss. Ronald, please accept the sympathy of this congregation to which you are an integral and important part. I'm going to take a wee drink. If you're happy and you know it. Oh, if you're happy and you know it. 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 If you're happy and you know and you really want to show it, if you're happy and you know it. If you're happy and you know it. If you're happy and you know it. If you're happy and you know and you really want to show it, if you're happy and you know it. Are you happy?
Yeah.
A couple of weeks ago, I said to you that above all things, God wants us to be happy. And I'm glad you're so happy. You know when I'm at my happiest? Well, one of the times I'm at my happiest, when I'm eating. As you can see, I love my food. Do you like your food?
Yes.
Sure. I'll tell you what, we'll see what you like. Hands up all those who like pizza. Oh, that's quite a lot, isn't it? Hands down. Hands up all those who like spaghetti bolognese. Oh, I think that almost beats pizza. Hands down. Hands up all those who like a McDonald's. Oh, just as well I'm not counting, isn't it? Right, hands down. Hands up all those who like KFC. Oh, that, I'm glad to hear that. I'm glad to see that. I'm not fussy on it myself. No. Don't like the chips. No. Hands up those who like mince and tatties. Ah. Oh, I better put my hand up. Because that's one of my favourites. I love mince and tatties. Hands down. Is there any meal that I've missed that you want to tell me? What is it?
Sausages.
Go on, you tell me.
Sausages.
Sausages. Oh, right, I'll try that one. Hands up those who like sausages. You should put two hands up because you, yeah, sausages. Yes, indeed. Any others that I've missed out? Not that you can think. I'll tell you what. Do you like your pudding? Hands up those who like pudding. I like pudding too. Here's a story about a pudding. Eh? Right. Once upon a time, a long time ago, when I was a student, and that is a long time ago, one of the professors, a man called Willie Barclay, who in his day was very, very famous indeed, invited his students to his house. And we were maybe 12 or 13 of us at a time, and we would sit in Professor Barclay's study, and the only thing that wasn't covered with books was the door, the window, and the fireplace. And at 20 past nine, exactly 20 past nine, something very lovely happened. Mrs. Barclay opened the door, and she pushed in this. Aha! And Mrs. Barclay produced this. Trifle. Oh. And she would go round all of us, it was all boys in those days, and she would go round all of us, and she would say, would you like a piece of trifle? And I would say, yes. And she went round one, two, three, four, five, six. Oh! Then she came to number six. And she said, would you like a piece of my sherry trifle? And Alexander was his name. And he said, no, thank you. I don't like sherry trifle. Oh, Mrs. Barclay wasn't very pleased. So she went across to Professor Barclay's desk and she said, Willie, one of your students has refused to take my sherry trifle. And so the professor got up from his seat and he walked across and he said, Alexander, do you wish to be a minister? And he said, yes, Professor. So he said, well, I would advise you to eat Mrs. Barclay's sherry trifle. And lo and behold, the command was issued, and Alexander ate, whether he liked it or not, Mrs. Barclay's sherry trifle. Which one will I have? I can't make up my mind. I'll leave it just now. This month, we're going to remember the patron saint of Scotland. Can you remember his name? Who's the patron saint of Scotland? Yes, shout it out. Andrew. A lovely name. If I'd been around at the time, I was going to ask my mother to give me that name, but I wasn't in a situation where I could actually tell her. Because I love that name. And Andrew, one day, was fishing. He was a fisherman, and he was with his brother Simon Peter mending their nets. And Jesus walked by, and he looked at them both, and he said, Andrew, leave your nets, come and follow me. Jesus issued the command, and Andrew obeyed. And he spent the rest of his life in the service of Jesus. And he is our patron saint in Scotland today. And we remember him this month. You and me are also followers of Jesus. We're trying to learn more about him and to become more like him. And because of that, we are going indeed to be very, very happy people most of the time. But I'll tell you what, I'm going to get you to be happy some of the time. Because you see, I've arranged that when you go through to junior church, you're all going to get a spoon and a plate, and you're all going to get trifle. Right. Now, Sunday school wasn't like that in your day, was it? No, it was not. That's right. So you're all going to get trifle. I think that's lovely, isn't it? By the way, I will count the number who are going out that door. No adults other than teachers allowed. So trifle it will be, and I hope you enjoy it. And if there's any left, remember me. But I don't suspect there'll be any left at all. At least, I hope not. Right now, we're going to sing a song. We're going to sing it in English, and then we're going to sing the last verse in a language called Xhosa. Xhosa, which is a South African language. Nelson Mandela spoke Xhosa. And we're going to sing it. So, in part, your luck's in and your luck's not in. I'm the cantor, so I'll sing the first line and then you come in. All of you, by the way, come in and sing. Have we got it up? We have indeed. We've got it up. Ronald, will you play the opening bar for me? You ready? Send me, Lord, send me. Send me, Jesus. Send me, Jesus, send me, Lord. sixth verse. Lead me, Lord, lead me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus, lead me, Jesus, lead me, Lord. Fill me, Lord, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Jesus, fill me, Lord. Thumamina, 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 song and love. Oh, lovely. Now it's time to escape. And whatever else awaits you, the curry doesn't get cold. Or not the curry. Well, if you get curry, let me know, that's right.
Our first reading this morning is taken from Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, and your endurance. I know that you cannot tolerate evildoers. You have tested those who claim to be apostles, but are not, and have found them to be false. I also know that you are enduring and bearing up for the sake of my name, and that you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then, from when you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Yet this is to your credit. You hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To everyone who conquers, I will give permission to eat from the tree of life that is in the paradise of God. And our second reading is from John chapter 14, verses 1 to 11. And it's entitled, Jesus, the Way to the Father. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe because of the works themselves. Amen. May God bless these readings from his holy word.
The hymn 465, Be Thou My Vision, O Lord of My Heart. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Two weeks ago, I sought to affirm the priority of worship as essential to the life of the Church. Today, I wish to affirm the central belief of the Church, for the Church to be the Church. Like you, I sometimes receive phone calls in which the caller says, "Hello, it's me." And after about 3 minutes, I've worked out who me is. But the strangest phone call I have ever received was some time ago when I answered the phone and the voice said, "Hello, is that you, Rab?" And I said, "No, it's not Rab." And he said, "Are you sure it's not Rab?" I said, "And I'm sure I'm not Rab." He paused and then said, "Do you breed budgies?" I says, "No, I don't breed budgies." He said, "Are you sure you don't breed budgies?" I said, "I'm sure I don't breed budgies." And at that, he put down the phone. He was only interested in me at all if I was Robert and if I bred budgies. He wanted me to be what he wanted me to be, to categorize me, to be that which would satisfy him. But he's not unusual, of course, for all of us are in the habit of categorizing people socially, economically, racially, or whatever. We feel comfortable with people when we have them secure in the category in which we wish to place them. And in religion, it is exactly the same. Some time ago, when I was still ministering in Hamilton, we had in the town centre churches what we called Kirk Week. And we had a multitude of activities, one of which was a brains trust. Now, I don't know how I get involved in a brains trust. They must have been short of volunteers. But anyway, I took part in this question session. And after it was finished, a man came up to me and said, "Mr. Barry, I don't quite know where to place you. Where do you stand on matters spiritual? What exactly are you in terms of Christian belief?" He wanted to place me in a category where he could understand and where perhaps he could even cope with me. I answered as follows, and I was always forever very pleased with the quick retort on thought that came out. I said, "Well, I'm a liberal Catholic evangelical," which was every category I could think of. His face dropped sadly, for I claimed to belong to every religious category that ever was. And although it was a quick, maybe a clever retort at the time, it was, in fact, a statement of truth on behalf of myself. For I am all of these things. I am a liberal in my understanding and interpretation of Scripture and in matters theological. I am a Catholic in my understanding of the nature of the Church, its divine origin and its corporate nature, and of the centrality of Word and Sacrament, and the essential Christ-givenness of the ministry of Word and Sacrament. I am an evangelical in terms that the purpose of my being and of my ministry is to proclaim the uniqueness of Christ and to commend to all the fullness of the gospel and the enduring vitality of the kingdom of God. And the first two categories are the servant of the third category. Hans Kung was a very liberal Catholic theologian and didn't find favor much with the Vatican. He He wrote many books, but in one called What Must Remain, he says that the only thing that must remain for the church to be the church is Christ. Karl Barth, the most gifted theological mind of the 20th century, says in his book Credo that Christianity does not exist in any respect apart from the person of Christ. Well, you may say, we know that. You're just stating the obvious, Arthur. But am I? It all depends on what you mean by Christianity. By Christianity, do we mean a code of ethics by which we live? Or a philosophy of life in which we gain understanding of our being? Or an ideology to which with security we can adhere? Or a set of virtues to which we try to attain? Christianity can and does provide all of these things. But separately, or together, they do not make up essential Christianity. Christianity is Christ, says Barth, no more, no less. What do I mean? I mean Christianity exists to confront men and women, not with a philosophy, not with a system of ethics, however noble, however true. It exists to confront us all with the person of Christ. Any reading of the scripture, listen, one or two quotes that were read to us this morning. Jesus always places himself at the center of his message. He does not say, for example, truth is everything, I am nothing. What does he say? I am the truth. He does not suggest or claim to suggest answers to the world's problems. He claims in many ways to be the answer. Come, come unto me, and I will give you rest. He does not offer a code, a philosophy. He does not deal with the uncertainties of life. But in the uncertainties of life, he says, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Christianity, according to Jesus, if that phrase makes sense at all, is a relationship between persons, between himself and the person, or it is nothing. The truth of this is strengthened by the evidence of those who knew him. Let me call some witnesses in the defense of what he claimed. Let me call, first of all, St. Paul. What is the first thing that strikes you about Paul? His towering intellect? His philosophical turn of mind and phrase, his theological technique, all of these are true. But the most striking thing about Paul was that he was a man possessed, yes, possessed by Jesus Christ. To me, he once cried, "To live is Christ. I live, yet not I. Christ lives in me." That is Christianity according to Paul, a decisive relationship to the person of Christ. And now let me call a quite different type of man, Simon Peter. No intellectual, certainly. No subtle thinker. No great debater. Just a doubting, passionate idealist. Short on patience was Simon Peter, but bounding in enthusiasm, no doubt. But passionate about what? The rights of man? Christian philosophy? Not a bit of it. "Lord," he said, "to whom shall I go? You have the words of eternal life." Now let us call the church as a witness. Amidst the often depressing and sad story of the church, there are great periods of belief, periods when men and women, having encountered long periods of spiritual darkness, have met Christ in the events and circumstances of life and have given to him their love, their loyalty. Think of the very darkest days of the church, the first four centuries, under Roman emperors such as Nero and Diocletian, when the church and its people were martyred for their faith, when hell was a living reality rather than a future fear. Oh, let me tell you of a man called Polycarp, Bishop of Smyrna. He was called to the arena and asked to swear by the genius of Caesar. And he said this, 86 years have I served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I deny the one who saved me?" And he was thrown to the lions to be torn asunder. What kept these people going? A philosophy? A system of ethics? Go to the catacombs of Rome and you will find the answer to that question, for inscribed in the walls is the name of one ever recurring figure: Jesus the shepherd, Jesus the bridegroom, Jesus the prophet, priest, and king. Or let us move to the time of spiritual desolation in England, and the established church was moribund, a spiritual deadness held over the land. And there rose a movement called Methodism, John and Charles Wesley. What was its secret? What made it so successful where others had failed? Social passion? Organizational ability? A particular, peculiar theology? No, none of that. The secret was well described by Charles Wesley in his hymns. "Jesus, lover of my soul, met me to thy bosom fly. Thou art Christ, And all I want, more than all in thee, I find. Yeah, we're back to it again, aren't we? A relationship with Christ. There was a famous church in Ephesus. Stuart read to us about it in Revelation. Its tragedy, says the writer of Revelation, was that it had lost its first love. Every revival in the long history of the church has occurred when the church has regained its first love. When it rediscovers the person of Christ. Bernard of Clairvaux, Francis of Assisi, and numerous others who have changed the face of the church all had one thing in common. It was a burning passion for Christ, an absorption with him, in him, that drove them to the limits of their being. But that is not just true for Paul and Peter and Francis and Bernard and present inadequate ministers. It is true and must be true for ordinary folk, however hesitant, however inarticulate we may be. All that way from the upper room to the 21st century, there has been an unbroken line of men and women who have borne witness to the truth as they saw it, heard it, and lived by it. 10,000 are their tongues, and all their hearts are one. Those who by baptism have been incorporated into Christ. Fortunately for you, I will go no longer. This is then the evidence. And with such testimony behind us, we must affirm anew today that the indispensable center of belief is the person of Christ. In the words of my favorite hymn, Christ is made the sure foundation, Christ the head and cornerstone. Chosen of the Lord and precious, binding all the church in one. Holy Zion's help forever, and her confidence alone. To him, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and praise. Amen. The hymn 461, How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds. Our offering will now be received. Dedication of our offering, let us pray. Out of your providing, Lord, we make this offering, brought from our daily living. Sanctify your gifts and bless the life from which they come, that with cheerful spirit and ungrudging hearts, we may indeed be true and devoted to your service, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. 2 weeks ago, I said to you I was struggling for words over the situation that faces us in the world today. And as I observe from afar, I still struggle with words. One or two of you said to me, after it, that they appreciated me simply giving, as it were, a heading and allowing you to pray your own prayers. And that's what I'm going to do again this morning. Let us pray. For the people of Gaza, for those in power, and for those who seek to alleviate the suffering, the hunger, and the thirst of so many. For the people of Israel, in their anger, and for their government and military, and for the Jewish community in our land of the United Kingdom. For our own country, for Charles, our King, for the Prime Minister, the government, the leaders and members of the opposition parties at Westminster. For those who suffer in mind or body, for those afflicted by life-denying illness, especially those known to us and loved by us. for the Church in Scotland and the Church of Scotland, for our own parish of St. Mary's in all its activities, for both the old and the young, the active and the inactive. For those whom I have not mentioned, but deserve our prayers. Eternal God, sinners find mercy in you, and saints find joy. You hold all souls in life. The dead as well as the living are in your care. We thank you for your people of every age and place, for those that died and are dear to our hearts, especially those of our membership here. Remembering them and those whom they feel bereaved on, who kept the faith on earth, and have entered into the joy of your heavenly presence. Inspired by their example, encourage us by their fellowship, and bring us with them at the last to the glory everlasting. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen. The hymn 181, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Thank you.
Go in peace, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you.